Yeah, good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure now for the last day to give the first talk. Again, I'd like to acknowledge some co-workers who did most of the work. Again, Volker Papa, especially, he's a PhD student of mine, and then also colleagues from the British and Arctic Survey, Fausto Ferraccioli, Valentina Balletta from DTU Space, and Giovanna Marcelloni. And you will see later on in which parts they all have contributed. Now, if I got the title Linking Solid Earth and Cryosphere in Antarctica, so don't expect too much on the cryosphere. I just give you the challenges that we have to actually to give some reasonable solid Earth results to the cryosphere. And you will see there are sometimes better not to give any model than a wrong model to the cryosphere community. Otherwise, you get a bad reputation. I start off with a short movie, and that's actually giving you, again, the potential that we have with ghosts and grays and measuring time variable changes in masses. And that was a question yesterday, why don't we use GOES really to look at the time variation? So if we zoom in Antarctica, and this is the Amundsen Sea embayment, Western Antarctica, where you might know there's a lot of rapid ice loss. There we had the GRACE data. So you see the tandem flying over Amundsen Sea embayment. And that's then you can calculate not only the gravity, but also gravity gradients as a form of low resolution, as I explained yesterday. If you zoom in, it goes, and now you see that we get a far better resolution. And this has again to do with the lower orbit height, and you get an enhanced. Now, I have to say that's a fortunate situation because the tracks were exactly about this area, and it's not something you can do on a global scale. And from this, of course, you can calculate then also the ice mass change. And this is an area where you see the potential of using the GOES data in addition to the GRACE data to really pinpoint where is the ice mass change in this area. And Amundsen Sea embayment, and you know, if it jumps to the next, again, the low resolution that we have from GRACE for the period where you don't really see where the ice is or where the mass change is occurring. And if you then for GOES, you can really, again, more pinpoint and also get a better quantification of the amounts. And you see the numbers here, it's a huge ice loss, minus 67 gigaton per year, minus 63, minus 55. So that's where most of the ice loss in Antarctica is occurring. So, and that's actually something which is, as you will see in the next slide, something that is very rapidly, and you can basically only explain it by a very low mantle viscosity. And it means that it's more an instantaneous process already. It's not something like normal GIA where you think about longer timescales and there's a response, but this is something where the system seems to be accelerating since a while, and really that you more have a kind of more elastic or instantaneous response than just the normal where you have also the viscosity in play. And it means really that the signal has maybe a memory only of a few hundred years. So, and this is the app GPS rates that you see here as well, and different models, and you really just need a very low elastic lithosphere. Now, if you look at the ice history of the area, and you can use different ice models for this, then you can actually see that the minus 130 gigaton per year, which I estimated for this one area, which is recent, cannot be going on for quite a long time. If this would be going on for quite a long time, there should be no ice in Amundsen Sea embayment. So there's really something that happened around the year 2002, maybe, that we went from a system where you had an ice loss in the order of maybe 32.5 gigatons per year to something which is four times, or even more than four times the ice loss. Now, that's the year where where GPS instruments were installed. So that's a little bit coincident. It's also the time when GRACE was starting to fly. So the question is really, is this the pinpoint or maybe the ice history? And this is a little bit, so it's not clear that it's really year 2002 where this has started, but it's clear that it cannot go on for quite a long time. Otherwise, you see where we would end up in this envelope and then again. So it might be something has changed. There's some recent discussions that maybe we're going into a system where we over the threshold and suddenly there's a rapid acceleration because there's so less ice that actually the system is now basically losing itself, dissolving itself. Before we had a relatively stable system and now suddenly something has changed. And the question is why? And of course there are different reasons. Climate change is always coming into play, but there might be also other things like which help to accelerate the system, for example, geothermal heat flow. There are some ideas that there is a, quite elevated geothermal heat under this part of Western Antarctica. And maybe there's some form of trigger that has changed in the system, in a solid Earth system. But on the time scale, normally solid Earth changes are really slow and do not accelerate so far, so fast. But it might be that just the ice is so thin, and then you have the elevated geothermal heat at the same time, that it helps actually to accelerate the system. So that you basically have, at some stage, went over the threshold, and then the geothermal heat really helped you to get rid of the ice. The other thing is, of course, the grounding line. So maybe the ice retreat has changed, that suddenly you have a different grounding line. This also helped to accelerate the entire system. So important are the conditions, of course, at the bottom and at the surface of the ice. And what we as a solid Earth geophysics community can try to do is actually get you a better estimate of what is happening at the bottom of the ice, and then try to quantify how much is the contribution of the solid Earth. And that's important not only for Western Antarctica, the same holds for Eastern Antarctica, even though there's some ice gain and some ice loss, but also then in terms of glacial melting, so melting at the base of the ice, so how much is the contribution of solid Earth, how much is related to other processes. And really the question is then what bothered me, or still bother me for a while, is actually this elevated geothermal heat. Is this a contribution at least for the rapid acceleration of what is going on there? If you speak about elevated geothermal heat, you will always come to these two maps, and these are the classical geothermal heat flow maps that you see for Antarctica. The left one is from An et al. That's based on seismological results, that's relatively recent. And to the right, you see the heat flux from Fox Maud et al. From the year 2005. Now, I will explain a little bit later what they are based on and why there may be some difference between the two maps. But you can see, and that's the right half, can say at this stage, this is based on satellite magnetic data, but at the time of Ørsted and really vintage satellite data, low resolution. So it's not very precise, and also the data coverage was not ideal. This, based on a seismological model, also has a certain form of parametrization for the crust and so on. If you look at these two maps and just concentrate on the Amundsen Sea embayment, in both maps you actually see quite high heat flow. In the one, you see something in the order of 70 to maybe 70 milliwatt per square meter, but normally in the order of 60 milliwatt per square meter. That's a little bit elevated. That's not really high heat flow. If you think about tectonic domains, normal, like in Western Europe where we are, you have normal 60, 65 milliwatt per square meter is quite normal. If you go to Scandinavia, there you maybe have 55 milliwatt per square meter because you're more in the old cratonic parts. So, but for a younger tectonic unit, this is not really a high elevated region. So, if you look at the other map to the right, there you see in the Fox Maud estimate, you see this line which is seen here, where you have elevated heat flow in the order of up to 100 milliwatt per square meter, and that's pretty high. So that's where you maybe would expect an active rifting, or maybe where you have some volcanism in the area. And there are some indications for active volcanism, but not in this part, but they're more here on the Mary Bird Island. So it might be reasonable, but which one of the two maps is correct? So that's the question. And if you just look at the differences between the two maps, then you see that the differences are up to plus minus 30 milliwatt per square meter over the entire scale of Antarctica. For the area we are talking about, it's still 20 milliwatt per square meter, and that's a third of the signal that we observe, kind of up to 20 to 30% of the signal. So it's a very huge uncertainty and a very large mismatch between the two estimates. So that's the motivation to go from the talk. And so the question is, what can we learn now going to more detailed solid Earths looking in Antarctica without the ice? So it means we're not really interested in the ice itself, we're looking what is in depth, what is beneath the ice. And of course, Antarctica is challenging as a geophysicist or as a geologist. You cannot really map the geology. There are only some outcrops at the coastal lines and maybe in the transantarctic mountains. But as you know, most of the continent is covered by ice. So we have to use other methods to go for the structure of the Antarctic continent, then actually estimate how hot is Antarctica. And that might be a strange statement, but Antarctica seems to be in some parts quite hot, despite the ice on top. And then really, can we give an estimate of the solid Earth, how it actually affecting the cryosphere at the end? And that means then the change, the ice mass change and the ice changes. And again, this is what we know about Antarctica in terms of geology. That's a low resolution picture, but you still see that there is a white spot just in the middle. And this is a Gondwana reconstruction of Antarctica, where they used all geological information they have. And you see the beautiful mapping of South America, Africa, Australia, and then just the white blob, which is in the middle. And this is really still the knowledge that we have of the geology of Antarctica. From direct mapping, you have to get indirect evidences to actually get some idea. And you could, and this is now GOES, getting a better picture by looking at the gravity field. And if you just use the recent results, and this is some polar gap data from some airborne campaigns in the central part, then you see that we suddenly have a better idea what might go on beneath the ice. General terms, not sure how familiar you are with the geology of Antarctica, but we have this East Antarctic block, which is a cratonic part. The question is, this is a one cratonic block, or maybe one, two, three cratonic blocks, which are emulgated and quite constant since the break of Antarctica. And then, of course, we have Western Antarctica, where there is the Western Arctic Rift Zone going in beneath. We have the Antarctic Peninsula, where there was some subduction. So there might be some remnants of the subduction. We have the active volcanism, which is still here. There are also some discussions if there might be a plume sitting under Mary Birdland, also elevating the geothermal heat. That's not something you can see in the gravity field, but you see already in the gravity field that the white blob is a little bit more structured inside than, you know, from geology. Now, of course, always seismic data are quite important to estimate the crustal structure. For Antarctica, unfortunately, there's not so much seismic data available. It's not as bad, you might say, as maybe in Africa. But if you look here to the right picture, these are all the active seismic data and also passive seismic data, which have been acquired. So receiver function, reflection, refraction seismics. And to the left are two MOHO-DEPS compilations just based on the seismic data. And they again show the same picture. You have here East Antarctica, pretty thick crust, up to 40 kilometers. And then you have the more thinner part in West Antarctica, where you have maybe more elevated geothermal heat because you have a thinner lithosphere. And as East Antarctica has a thick crust, but still you would expect that you have less radiogenic heat production because it's older and more depleted lithosphere and crust. So it's actually less producing elements. So similar again to, that's maybe Scandinavia, and this you could say it's Western Europe if you want to give an analogy to this. The two maps look at first glance quite similar, but again, you look at some particular features like here under the Gamburtsev Mountains. There, this is more broad wavelengths, and this is more a little bit shorter wavelengths, has more structure. And if you look at the difference between the two maps, and that's the more interesting, then you see that there are differences plus minus 20 kilometer. And if you remember what I said yesterday, every geophysicist give you a good depth of a crustal thickness up to plus minus 10 kilometer. So we have two maps which are plus minus 20 kilometer. So there's kind of a mismatch between what I said yesterday and what we see on the two maps. So the question is, where is this mismatch coming from? And the mismatch can be explained just by how you interpret seismic data for crustal thickness. This is from the Arnold Alt, and he actually, for this profile, which is running from the Trans-Scandinavian Mountains to the Gamburtsev Mountains, these are different points. And the blue ones, these are points which are basically used for the Baranov compilation, while the red one, and so all these which are encircled, these are the points that are used by Arnold Alt in his estimate of the MOHO depths. So why did one group choose the blue points and the other group choose the red points? And sometimes even they choose the blue points even if there's a red point. It's a different technique. It's S-wave and P-wave receiver function. Normally you use P-wave receiver function. It's the first wave, the first arrival wave, to estimate across the thickness. However, under the ice, you have reverberation of the data, And then people tend to use the S-wave data instead of the P-wave, what you would conventionally use. In other cases, like if you go to Scandinavia, everyone is using the P-wave, there's no ice, and then they use the S-wave to estimate the lithospheric thickness. So there is, and if you go in literature and look for the reasoning why the S-wave is using, you find there's a circle of arguments in the authors that you end up with the author that you started, you end up with the same author at the end. You go a circle, and there's not clearly a synthetic example which is really convincing that you can find literature. So it's more like experience from data over ice. And a lot of experience has been made in Greenland, and maybe the conditions in Greenland are not quite the same that you have in Antarctica. So that's something to be very careful, and of course now we could use gravity to actually get a better grip on which of these two estimates are correct, or maybe to evaluate what does it mean in terms of using these different estimates. And so we went for some lithospheric modeling, and I'm just quickly have this slide for the methodology. That's pretty complex. That's you see we use a lot of geometry, density, compressibility of the rocks, thermal expansion, heat conductivity, radiogenic heat production. Basically, we use mineral properties, petrophysics, there's purple X, there are different classes of rock types, and under certain pressure and temperature conditions, they behave differently and have different properties. And this you can exploit in an inverse or forward manner to get a better idea how the lithosphere is changing. And then you do, so you look for the stable minerals as well, and then you get a lot of outputs, and this is an iterative loop, either by the inversion or by the forward modeling to get to a good solution. Not spending too much time on this, just the idea is the same I showed yesterday. You have the different classes, you have basically Archean, Proterozoic, Phanerozoic, and according to the age, the lithosphere is changing. Older rocks tend to be colder and less, more depleted, while the younger rocks seem to be more heat producing, therefore the system is normally warmer and they're more rich, enriched on iron. Good. With this short words on the methodology, just we developed two models, and for the one we used the shallow MOHO, so that's where we use the blue points, so to say, and then we used the model with the deep MOHO, so the red points, so 30 to 40 kilometer. And this is now a lithospheric scale profile, so the crust would be only here, the upper part, and you see beneath is the mantle. And both, we tried to fit the geoid data and the gravity data, and here's actually shown topography in, as well, or topography and geoid on this. Both have a reasonable fit, so there's some mismatches in both models, but what we had to do is actually change the composition of the upper mantle. You see here, that's more Proterozoic, while we had here a transition between a Phanerozoic, Proterozoic mantle. So it means there seems to be an indication, or if the deep MOHO is correct, we need to change something in the upper mantle. So we need to change some thermal parameters as well. If you calculate seismic velocities, they also look pretty much the same. You see some local variations, but if you compare this to seismic tomography, it's pretty similar, and again, that's the reason that seismic tomography picks up thermal structure first place and not so much the composition. So the compositional changes are just the secondary order. So you could say, okay, now we have two models, and we can fit both, so do we learn anything from this exercise? We do if we look at the heat flow, and this is shown here, and if you look now, this is the observed heat flow. Also there we could discuss how accurate this is. It looks similar, there are some variations. Generally, this model is a little bit warmer, but especially here in the coastal area. And there's a large difference. In the shallow MOHO, you have this area of 70 to 65 millibar going into the land, so from the coast, inside the land, for up to 400 kilometer, while in this you have a very sharp gradient at the coast. And of course, that is a difference if you have a warmer system more prograding into the continent, or you have a warm system which is just at the coast, and you normally, that's we know, at the coast you have rifted margins, there we should have high heat flow, and then it's just declining to a normal volume. So a deep MOHO would require a high density, young, fertile lithospheric mantle for the isostatic compensation and for the gravity, and a shallow implicates the average protozoic mantle and then a high heat flow at the coast. So, and that's then, of course, if you do ice sheet modeling or something like this, and you need a boundary condition, you would like to know which of the two models you should now use. And again, you can go to other surface heat flow estimates, and this is from Matos et al. It's a very recent study. And in her study, you see everything is pretty cold. It's 40 to 50 milliwatt per square meter. And there was a study for Greenland published some years ago, and Irina Rogoshina, she tried to use a lot of the different estimates that you have for geothermal heat flow from solid earth geophysics, and none of the models was fitting with her ice sheet history. So her paper concluded with, it's better to use just the constant value than to use any of the models which just give you wrong values. And I think that's a challenge for the solid earth community now, to give some realistic estimate and not just yet another model which fits some data but doesn't really help the modeling, the ice sheet modeling community. If we validate the two models, again, against the gravity field, you also see the huge differences. And normally, that's the dominating effect, the crust mantle boundary in the gravity field. This is just the residuals, which are really high. They're twice as high as the signal. So these models in terms of gravity are wrong, or you might say there's something missing. So we have to at least look for the upper mantle, or we maybe have also to look for the crust to actually explain the mismatch between the seismic estimates and the gravity field. So that's what we did. So we extended these 2D modeling studies, which are just the first order study to get some overview for the entire continent in 3D, using then really basing this a lot of on the GOES gravity gradients. You see it's a basic, pretty, that's a typical setup of the model. You have some of the crust, you have then the upper mantle where you model the density, and then you derive at the same time from this purple X, from this mineral composition, also temperature and composition. And then we also model the seismic velocities anomaly to get a better agreement with some, with at least the seismological data. One technical slide again, of the Litzesberg modeling setup. That's the dimension, so it's a very huge model. You see 6,500 to 6,500 kilometers, 2 400 kilometer depths, and that's what you normally, you model the upper mantle, and then it's the 410 transition zone where you go into the convective mantle, you stop there. Resolution, the order of 50 to 50 kilometer lateral, and then 2 kilometer in vertical. That's probably a little bit over the top what you can really resolve, but just for the calculation, because you do a fine element calculation, that's quite okay. And so what we did in the first model was trying to do some division of Antarctica, and that's basically the knowledge that you have. So you have the Western Arctic part, the rift zone, the Eastern Arctic block. So we used this as a first order constraint in the model, and then looked how far we get with this simple division, and then refine the model step by step. You see also this fake mantle domains, different composition parts. They won't say you too much if you're not into geology, but again, they're different age parts, and then also for the rifting, for example, you have a more primitive, more primordial mantle material, because that's something which is coming directly from the asthenosphere and it's just very young. You also see then in the cross section, the different transition between this different parts, and that's again then something you need to also model the seismic velocity anomalies. Of course, for the model you need a lot of constraints. We tried to get some idea about the sediment thickness of Antarctica, but that's almost an impossible task because again there's not a lot of seismic which are looking at the shallow structure. You can divert to some magnetic anomalies, but that's really very unconstrained. Here in the Weddell Sea you have some estimates. Otherwise, we started with this Arnett Al model, where you have a MOHO depth and LAB, and of course, the only surface that we know pretty good, even there is also some uncertainties, is the bedrock topography, so the topography under the ice. So we, in this case, came up with 3 models. So we started with model 1, which is just the homogeneous crust and the very rough mantle domains, as I've shown before. And you show this is the model, this is then the residual against topography. I could also show the residual against gravity. Basically, the model doesn't fit. You have very large deviations up to 1,000 meters, which means that the net cannot be explained by GIA or something else, so just the model is wrong. So the initial parameterization was not good enough. So that's a high misfit. And so how the question is how to fit the misfit, so how to attach. There are 2 approaches. You can divert to go to isostasy and say that's your dominating effect. GIA has the contribution, but it's in the order of maybe 50 to 100 meter. So not a lot of topography can be explained by GIA. So you can refine crustal structure, look for different mantle blocks, try to improve the gradient fit, but make really the most important constraint is to fit topography at the end. So to make a model that fits topography and to see how much this fits also the gravity gradients at the end. Model 3 is the other philosophy. We gave up on the concept of isostasy, but we modeled the gravity gradients. And at the end, you see how much you actually fit a topography or is there a mismatch. And so these models are different philosophies you can approach the problem. And then you will see in a few moments what is the effect of this. You see, if you go from the residual one, which is very high, then we went to a more defined crustal architecture. Model 2 fitted to elevation, and of course you see that's almost perfect, so there's almost no mismatch except the Weddell sea, and that's probably that our sediment model and the one part where we had sediments is wrong. So that was also kind of not the result that you would like to see, but it's the realistic modeling part in geophysics. But of course then otherwise you can fit perfectly topography. Now model 3 is fitted to gradients, so we gave up the concept of isostasy. You get mismatches, but they are not so huge. So the Weddell sea again is pretty wrong, up to 400 meter. If you go for the rest, that's in the order of maybe plus minus 200 meter. And mostly shifted to the positive values, so there might be even a shift in this, but you cannot expect with the lithospheric model to model topography perfectly. So having something like 100 meter is perfectly fine because we know we have dynamic contributions from the mantle, which might push up the system. You have local geology, which is not included, which might locally, with a slight change of density, contribute in the order of 50 to 100 meter. So modeling something with plus minus 100 meter, you're perfect. Modeling something with plus minus 200 meter is pretty good. So the model is, despite that we didn't try to model topography, is matching topography quite good. Now, the other is now how the two models fit the gravity gradients. And so the one where we went for the topography, this is actually showing huge mismatches to topography to the gravity gradients. It's better than the initial model, but still there are large deviations. And the other model is actually, you see some regional trends, so some trending in the data, but otherwise that's as good as fit as you can get, basically. So there are some boundary effects from outside the study area and so on. So that's a very good fit. And that shows you again that by using gravity gradients as an input to derive such models, you somehow independently, indirectly also model other data like topography. So gravity gradients really have this advantage of having this directional sensitivity and this different depth sensitivity that allow you to derive reasonable lithospheric models pretty much by only using a few constraints. So they have a so that's a very nice advantage. So this is at the moment our preferred model really. While this model we would say at the end, okay, there are some masses which we didn't properly address by using not the gravity gradients to the full extent. Look at temperatures, and if you look for the profile which is going here from Western Arctica to Eastern Arctica, they look pretty similar on a first glance. If you look in more detail, so that's from the seismic tomography, but it's basically just converting velocity anomalies to temperature. there are some changes, especially here in the transition zone between Western and Eastern Arctica, between the different models. The first one, which is based on these seismic data, is pretty long wavelengths, while these tend to have this transition zone a little bit better. So they're quite similar, you would say, but actually you see that this model, I prefer the third model, let me put it this way. You can also look what is the contribution of different mantle parts and so on, and this is just an example using an Akin mantle in the eastern part and or not, and you see that you have this kind of heat flow blobs and low heat flow blobs popping up, and this is just the effect by changing the composition in these three areas compared to a more homogeneous model. So it does matter what we do with the model, and it has an effect on the heat flow. Now, do we have solved the heat flow problem? No, we haven't. So here are five different heat flow data sets. Now we're getting even more complicated, even more data, as show around. Sorry. So what are these data? So that's the GOES gravity gradient fitted data set. That's satellite magnetic. That's from ice temperature, that's from seismology, and that's from airborne magnetic. And that's the recent, most recent study, which also had the title Heat Flow in Antarctica Unveiled. You see a lot of differences in terms of the structure, in terms of the wavelengths. You see there's an overall agreement with all of these data sets, East Antarctica is colder than West Antarctica. But if you look in more details and you need a detailed resolution for ice sheet modeling, you're not interested to know we have East and West Antarctica, you need something more than this, then you see there's a lot of differences. So why is this? In our data sets, we basically did not model the crust to the full extent. So we don't really have, so this is the background heat flow, I would say. That comes from the lithosphere and due to radiogenic heat production in the crust, but it's not addressing really local geology. Airborne magnetic is using magnetic data, and magnetic data are very sensitive to your local geology. So that basically gives you an idea what is happening beneath your measuring point. Satellite magnetic data, pretty low resolution, and this is not using the new satellite data. Seismology is somehow converting what is in the mantle to the crust, and the ice temperature model I'll come back to in a second. So what we need, instead of five different heat flow models where we get again the same answer that none of the models fits or does help the modeling community, we need some form of analysis of the uncertainties in the solid earth models, and then the feedback to the ice temperatures. So we can do the joint analysis, we can do Curie depth estimates like for the magnetic estimates, and then this is the most important, we have to make some form of reconciliation of the solid earth models and ice temperature profile. So we need to go into the cryosphere and need this information also in top of our solid earth modeling, and then looking for the really at the end, the implications for ice sheet modeling. Just one word on this ice sheet temperature profile. This was from the cryo-ESMA study from Giovanni Marcelloni. And the reason why this was only in East Antarctica is that they have typical conditions they need that they can actually calculate with the L-band radar, the ice temperature. And then under certain conditions, they could estimate the heat flow. So they need absence of advection. So this is a typical condition only of the ice divides and domes. They need area where the snow accumulation is low and constant. And they actually need an ice thickness, which is a certain threshold. And they need, I think, 1 kilometer of ice at least. And that rules out quite a lot of area where you have ice dynamics. And then you can use a very classic formula from Robin. Looks very complicated. The ingredients are the ice thickness, the surface temperature that you can estimate, the geothermal heat flux, which is just something you can put in, but you also get it as an improved estimate out of the inversion, and the snow accumulation. And from this you see snow accumulation is only constant in the terms for them constant in East Antarctica. Now, the nice thing is that this inversion is mostly relying on the ESMOS, the cryo-ESMOS, or the ESMOS data from the satellite, and not so much on the geothermal heat flux. This is just something you put in, but you give a lot of freedom. So this model is just to have something at the start, but can be iterated by their inversion. And most important is that you actually fit the temperature profiles in the ice, and this is shown here. And this is for different depths, surface temperature, 500 meter, 1 kilometer to 2 kilometer, and then you see how the ice temperature is actually changing with depths. And that's something they are directly using in their inversion. Now, if you do this and try to get a better grip on the geothermal heat flow, then actually you get from the input data to something like this, and that's the output that they have. Again, the limitations are that you're limited to a very small area, but you see even this, that you get more structure and heat flow is actually changing from very low values to more, I would say, normal values in terms of what I would expect from geology. So that seems to be a reasonable approach, but of course, if I want to model here in the Amundsen Sea embayment, it doesn't really help me if I know now I have a better heat flow estimate in East Antarctica. So I have to go back to other methods, magnetic data. And there's a new compilation, which is called ADMAP2, which is just released a few months ago, which is the best compilation of magnetic data of Antarctica, filled in by some satellite data. As you can see, the longer wavelengths part are filled in by satellite data. And then the authors, Martos et al., they used the classical method, which is based the centroid method, and came up with a surface heat flux. So is this now a reliable estimate? Well, what they rely on is, first of all, that they have to estimate a Curie isotherm. Curie isotherm is the 580-degree isotherm, where normal crustal material loses the ability to have a magnetization. So what they really estimate is the bottom of the magnetic material. And if you have the bottom of the magnetic material, you can say that's the Curie isotherm, then under certain conditions for radiogenic heat production, conductivity, you can estimate the surface heat flow. The problem is, and it's a very technical statement, magnetic data don't have long wavelengths. And this is something with airborne data, you can never have the long wavelengths, you need satellite data. And that's something they ignored in the study. So this is something they have an uncertainty of plus minus 2 kilometers. I would say the uncertainty is plus minus 10 kilometers at least. So there is a technical problem which is just inherent in aeromagnetic data. That's not their fault, but it's a nice approach actually, and they give, especially for Western Antarctica, where we have a more elevated Curie isotherm, here the estimates actually, I think, better than what has been done before. I would be pretty careful about using the data in East Antarctica. The important heat flow as output from a Curie isotherm, and this is assuming constant radiogenic heat production, thermal conductivity, and again, this Curie isotherm is the bottom of magnetic sources. A lot of literature, if this is reasonable or not, I'm not going to dwell into this kind of discussion. So what we tried, and this is a first order try, is try to reconcile the models, but not all of them. So we used the five models. We gave up on the satellite magnetic data from early this century because Ørsted really had only 400, 500 kilometer wavelengths, very imprecise. The seismology, we also gave up because that's based used on our GOES model. So we have used the seismological model. So we have used the information, and this is the geometry from these two models here. Crustal thickness based to the lithosphere, Curie isotherm, and use the standard Bayesian information, Bayesian inversion. Ice temperature is as well something that we are going to add in the next step. At the moment, we just had a relatively rough estimate, and it was just before the summer break that we did this. So these are the two data sets that we mostly rely on. See at least how much is it possible to make with an inversion to derive the parameters like radiogenic heat production that these models are consistent to each other. Now, the Bayesian inversion I explained yesterday, there's nothing really new to add, but again, we use the MOHO depths, we use the LAB depths, the lithosphere asthenosphere boundary, we use the Curie isotherm as the input data for our model, and these are the observed data, and the vector, and then the prior probability with the uncertainties that we have from the different models, and then again, define the likelihood of the models. This is just to give you some idea, that's the Curie isotherm that they had from the magnetic analysis. If we do this, we change, of course, the surface heat flow. And because we are inverting now for the radiogenic heat production, for the conductivity, and for the surface heat flow. So surface heat flow is not something that we put in, it's something that we want to get out of the model. And you see, if you do this, we go from the map by Martos et al. To this, and the changes are mostly in East Antarctica. So in Western Antarctica, the changes, there are also some changes that localize the structures change quite a bit, but in generally, the agreement from the long wavelength pattern is quite the same, but you see how much the inversion, this is now using the volume of radiogenic heat production elements and the background temperature from lithosphere is changing this. If we go for the differences, again, these are now plus minus 40, but this actually, this 40 I would ignore, but in the order of up to minus 40 milliwatt per square meter, especially over the Antarctic Peninsula, in the Weddell Sea where we know there are problems, and then in the order of 10 to 20 milliwatt. So they're not so bad, I wouldn't say that they're perfect, but it's just showing you the changes from the initial model. So with combining the information that we have from magnetic data with information from the GOES gravity gradients and from seismology. So it's, in terms, a better model because it tries to address more geophysical data. I'm not showing it's a good model, just a model that tries to be closer to the data that we have and not only relying on one particular data set. Now, you can also then look at the other parameters they get, like crustal heat generation, and this is inverted, and that's actually quite nice result because that shows geology, and that's what you would expect. Again, we have more colder part here in Eastern Antarctica. We see the rift zone to some degree, even though some co-authors don't like that it's not continuous to the Antarctic Peninsula. You see some local structures that you can really directly compare to geology. So it's some form of geological map. And if you compare here, that's to the values that have been used in previous studies. Martos et al., for example, used 2.5 microwatt per cubic meter, just as the one standard for the entire continent. And this is certainly for Antarctica not correct to use one value for the heat generation. In other studies like Cero C, she was modeling more the plume generation here, and there the values were even smaller. So also more or less what you see in this blue dot, but she modeled this entire area here. So that also would give now a constraint maybe to go back to these different studies and to use the heat generation. Now, while this is a promising result, we can look a little bit about the correlation between the input and the output parameters, and that looks pretty random. If you look at this, like crustal heat conductivity, this is has no correlation to any of the other results. You see some correlation between bestest between Curie isotherm and surface heat flux, but it gives you an idea which of the different elements actually is constraining or determining where the inversion goes. And the random correlation between parameters mean that they're not maybe not important, so you can to some degree ignore them and maybe use a constant value, or maybe that the data set that we have at the moment is not good enough to make a proper prediction. Again, the next step, what we should do is using ice temperatures as well as a better constraint to see if this helps in this analysis. And this is one example for the crustal heat conductivity, and you see, despite this feature here, the rest looks pretty random. And that's not something that you would expect, that you have just a random picture that, like Gaussian noise, basically. So it's really a parameter that we cannot, at the moment, not resolve. And maybe it's better just to use the standard value and to see like 2.6, 2.5 as an average value instead of trying to invert for this parameter as well. So maybe it's an under-constrained system. That might also be the case. Of course, there are heat flow values that you can measure at the surface that you can use. However, heat flow values at the surface always have the problem that they show you the local heat flow. Often there's some fluid circulation, there are local conditions in the melt, in the ice, which actually perturb the values. So it's always difficult to actually use measured heat flow in terms of this kind of modeling. My interpretation at the moment is actually that this analysis is too strong influenced by the magnetic heat flow estimates, so by the Curie isotherm, because this has such a huge uncertainty, and we actually should go back and use the magnetic data itself and not a product of the Curie isotherm, but actually try to develop a model that fits also magnetic data. But it's something classic. We have to go one step back to maybe go one step further in the analysis. that's already then a conclusion of this. So despite that I didn't show you a nice heat flow map and say that's the one you should use for ice sheet modeling, I just wanted to give you a little bit the challenges and the possibilities that you have. And especially for Antarctica, we all know that's quite important to have a better understanding of the continent. It's still not very much known. There's still a lot of gaps, but we're getting there and we have to integrate the different data sets. Especially the GOES data help to fill a lot of the gaps. SWARM has the potential, when it's eventually going a little bit in lower orbit, to maybe also help us with the lithospheric magnetic field. But at least at the moment, we have some heat, background heat flow, I would call it, which we can use for this form of inversion. And I think this probabilistic inversion is able to detangle the differences between the different geophysical estimates of the heat flow. And at the end, to give us some form of model that explains a lot of things, maybe not everything. And then, of course, it's a challenge to go for the ice sheet modelers again and try to link this to their modeling and to see how useful such a better estimate really is at the end. Now, I would like to leave you with one yet another movie, and that's a little bit off from the topic of the presentation, but it was something in the project that we had with colleagues, and this is a very slow movie, as you can see. Maybe I try to open this outside this presentation mode. If I find the folder. And the hope that this gets a little bit, yes, it's a little bit quicker. This was a recent science publication by Valentina Balletta, where she used the GPS data for the Amundsen Sea embayment again, actually nicely demonstrated why we have this low viscosity. And she did a lot of parameterization, a lot of sensitivity tests also in terms of inversion to really give a reliable statement there. And again, problem, or the challenge is there are only a few GPS stations in the area that you can use for the modeling. And then it's a little bit silly part, the GPS rays flying to the receivers, but then you go have some time to the deeper part, not the GOES satellite, and this gives you the analytospheric modeling. And again, what we try to do here is actually to combine this, the information that we have over the upper mantle and where's lithosphere, asthenosphere boundary, so in terms of the elastic response and the viscoelastic response to what is going on there, to the really rapid uplift. And it's clearly that the fast uplift means that the mantle is much softer, more fluid than previously expected. But again, the question is it only like since 2002 softer and more fluid than expected? That would be something which is pretty surprising. So there's certainly clearly the question of what is going on. So the rapid bedrock uplift has affected probably the stability of the ice. And this is the reason to some degree. But again, we need also to look a little bit at the background reasons which are behind and why it actually has been accelerating since 2002 so much. Well, thank you.
Okay, questions?
Yep. Hi, I've got a question about that kind of the idea that if then the bedrock is, or like the bedrock uplift is responsible for some of the ice sheet change that we see, would that be then, is that incorporated into climate change prediction and models which we are looking at kind of?
I don't think so that it's fully included yet. So that's something that has to be certainly done in more detail. I know that Valentina has been working with colleagues on this, but I think solid earth is often to some form, and this is then regarded a little bit ignored in this kind of predictions, because the effect is normally not very huge for the climate prediction, but I think it's for local structures it should be included more in the future.
Anyone else? Okay, just have a just a curiosity. What is the future of high-resolution gravity measurements? I mean, is cold atom interferometry a realistic prospect?
That's a very good question. I think, which timeline are we speaking about now? So cold atom, maybe we go for, I think it will take some 30 years before we go there. The other development I see actually is more interesting is the accelerometers, the same that you have in the smartphones and the mobile phones. There's this group from Edinburgh, they have used them for airborne gradiometer. And these have the precision that you can use them for, and that for airborne data, for acquisition. And that's certainly, because they're very small, and the accuracy is high enough, and I think the development in this direction is, in my terms, more promising than the cold atom. Yeah. But now I know that ESA is more going in the cold atom direction, but it's always the question, what are you interested in? If you go for airborne data and static measurements, I would go for maybe the accelerometer system. Cold atom is more for the time change, having a system which you can clearly control, which is in space for longer time.
Okay, thanks a lot. Okay, so thank you.